It's Advent 3, and we're still waiting. Those are the readings for today. How much longer, Dad, before we get there? I thought Christmas was coming, and here it is. It's not here yet. When is it ever going to get here? All three readings come out of the experience of waiting for God to show God's self. The Old Testament reading is actually transplanted in that bit of Isaiah. It comes after the restoration. They've already been exiled into Babylon. They've been restored by the Emperor Cyrus, the great liberal Persian Empire that lets them go back to their own land. As long as they pay taxes, you can have your own religion and be your own people. Woohoo! God is doing this, restoring us to the land. And they get to the land, and it's a devastation. And they go, maybe we're still waiting for God to do what God's going to do. And how long, how much longer do we have to wait for God to actually do what God has promised to do? The letter of James is written sometime after the resurrection, and they're waiting for the second coming, and it's going to happen any day right now. And they're waiting, and they're waiting, and they're waiting. And James says, be patient. Just be patient, it's going to come. And in the gospel reading, you have, again, the Israelites at the time of Jesus waiting for a Messiah. Still waiting. And John the Baptist was doing his thing, and finally he sends a message to say, are you it, or are we still going to be waiting? And the whole point on which my thoughts turn this morning is Jesus' answer to the disciples of John the Baptist. He doesn't say, no worries, it's over, I've arrived. It's not what he says. He says, look and see for yourselves. What do you see? And then he lists, the lame walk, the blind see, the deaf hear, the poor have good news brought to them. Look and see what's happening and decide for yourself whether the day of the Lord has come or not. And so my reflections this morning are on an evidence-based Christianity. That's my Christianity, by the way. I'm not given to accepting things once other people say so. Just because you tell me something, I would be polite and I would nod. I won't necessarily buy it, though, just because you feel really strongly about it. I need something tangible, I need something real, some evidence. And I was always like that growing up. I was raised in the church. My dad was a priest. He obviously believed something. I didn't really get it, but there it was. I went to church and I learned all the prayers and heard the Bible and got the whole thing. And still had this big question mark. Well, other people seem to believe this stuff, but it doesn't necessarily convince me because I haven't seen. What have I seen? But of course, there's another story that was running alongside that in my young life, which is the story of a young, awkward, socially outcast person. I was the classic, before nerds were cool, I was a nerd. I was the nerd that was getting shoved into lockers, you know? Because I was no good at sports, and I was a little bit insecure and awkward, and I was really good at school, and this was not okay in the school where I grew up. And so there was a part of me that had been consistently pushed down by the social experience of my peers. And I tell you this not because my story is so particularly special, but because it's the story I'm allowed to tell. I've heard many, many other stories that are similar to this, but of course they're confidential, and I cannot tell you those stories. But I tell you this only as an example of waiting and what God is doing, and look for yourself, and what is the evidence of Christianity. So here I am, a young man at the age of 14 or 15, who was spending more time in the imaginary world of Tolkien and Dungeons and Dragons than I was in the real world of peers and life and relationships and so on. And I would walk with my head down, my nose in the book, because it was safer that way. Because if I looked up, I'd probably get a shout and a push. My nickname, I went to school in a new school in grade 6, and this was a elementary junior high school, so I went all the way from kindergarten through to grade 9. So when I arrived in the new school in grade 6, all the friend groups were basically established, and I was the new kid. I got a lot of attention, and my mother made me wear a pink shirt on the first day of school. And I did, and I got bullied and teased for it, and I actually cried. when the kids bullied me, and that was it. So for the next 4 years of my life, my nickname was Fag. That was my name, you know? Hey, Fag, yes? Right, that was me. And so I was beaten down. My spirit was constantly beaten down by that experience of being in school. And I didn't think I had acquaintances. I wouldn't say I had friends. If they were nice to me, then I could hang with them until they got bored of me and went on to do something else. But I was not ever allowed in with the people that actually had real friends. And that was my experience of growing up. And throughout all that period, I was coming to church and hearing these weird words, these weird ideas. And in my early life, there was one particular experience, when mostly my experience of young life was negative. I didn't feel good every day, except that we were doing this confirmation class. And I went to confirmation class, I was all 12, I guess, 13. And I noticed that when I left confirmation class, I actually felt good. And it was so unusual that I took note of it. And I said, that's weird. We just talked about religion for a while, and I don't even think I believed any of it, but I feel different after that gathering than I did before. And I noticed it, and I took note at 12, I said, well, I don't know what that means, but there it is. And at the age of 15, I went to a youth retreat where the whole ethos of the retreat, it was a Christian Anglican youth retreat, where the whole ethos of the retreat was every single person that comes to this retreat is a child of God, and we will treat them that way. And so for the first time in my life, I was welcomed. And people asked me my name, and I didn't say back. My name is Chris. Hi, Chris. Nice to meet you. And they made a place for me that was as warm and inviting as anything I've ever experienced. Along with all the other kids that came at the same time, I was treated just the same as everybody else. It was in that context that I started to become healed of the damage that had been done to me socially through my early teens and those awkward junior high years. So the lame started to walk, right here. The blind started to see. I didn't know who I was. And I was able to find out who I was because I was, I didn't know I was a musician before I went to that youth thing. And then, of course, we were all singing the campfire Jesus songs, which was the style of the day. And I would just sing the harmony because my brain could do that. And everyone went, wow, you can do that? You should be on the music team. Really? Me? And so I picked up a guitar at age 15 to do it like fish to water. And so I've been a musician ever since. Wouldn't have known that, but for the church community that welcomed me and said, whoever you are, that's who we are welcome. So the blind saw, the deaf heard, the lame walked, the poor had good news brought to them. That's my evidence. And ever since I was 15, I've known the evidence of God at work. And what I had to do was learn how to look for that evidence. It wasn't literal blindness becoming sight, deafness becoming hearing, but it was spiritual. The broken was becoming healed. And I'm still broken. I'm still being healed. I'm not done. But I know from the evidence of my own experience that God is at work in the institutional church, believe it or not. I know those are dirty words. Those are four-letter words. I know. And yet, now I've told you my story, but I tell you, I've heard hundreds of similar stories with my brothers and sisters in the Christian faith, in the institutional church, since becoming a pastor. I've heard those stories. I've seen the blind start to see, the lame start to dance. I've seen the poor in spirit have good news brought to them, and all of a sudden they discover they are richer than they think. Sorry, that's Scotiabank. Sort of the Scotiabank of the soul. But you are richer than you think. When you feel poor in spirit, there's a richness available to you that only you need that support, that encouragement, that opening of the heart to the presence of God in the day-to-day life to see the evidence that the time is near. And it's never 100% arrived. There's always a not yet to it. It's never perfect. You know, although these days my theology is that I'm actually glad it's not perfect. I think that that not being perfect is part of the design. Otherwise we get attached to this life a little too much. And I think that we still need to be called into the next life. And there's a sweetness at the end of that. So there's a not yet quality to it, and yet there is, just open your eyes and look and see what you can see. And that's just my perspective. If you are having a hard time waiting for God to arrive in your life, in your experience, in the world, the lesson from the scriptures today, just look. Look at what you see. And implicit in that is learn how to pay attention. Because Jesus didn't come on a horse with an army to liberate Israel from the Romans, which is what everyone was expecting Jesus to do. And it didn't look like that, and it wasn't what we asked for. And yet, once you learned how to look, the signs were all there of the imminent kingdom of God. So, are you coming, or are we still going to be waiting forever? Look around. Tell me what you see. Do you see the blind starting to see? Do you see the deaf starting to hear? The lame starting to walk? The poor receiving good news? Wherever you see that, the kingdom is coming. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.